Before I go into discussion of Chapter 7, I just want to give you again a quick little historical rundown of the history of catalysis as it applies to cracking, catalytic cracking. As you recall, the first lecture we talked about Eugene Hudry, that brilliant debonair Frenchman who first discovered the cracking catalyst, that he could make high-octane gasoline with an acid-treated clay. And that led to a fixed-bed process with pellets in a bed in which the oil was passed down through. After a certain period of time, the catalyst was fouled, the oil was stripped off, air was passed in, the catalyst was regenerated, and the cycle repeated. And the catalysts got a little harder and a little better, but they were large pellets. And then, as you recall, Exxon, an individual from MIT, decided there ought to be an easy way to move this catalyst around. And they came up with the fluid bed process, the idea of moving powder as a fluid and back and forth from the regenerator to the reactor. And the fluid catalyst was born. And the first catalysts were either clays, ground, first calcine, then ground, or later on, microspherical material. Microspheres didn't come along at first. Really, the idea of a microsphere came later. But the idea of moving catalysts about took on another approach, and that was to develop a bead catalyst that could flow from the reactor to the regenerator and back. And I think you recall we talked about the old bucket elevators that were used to lift this catalyst up and then flow it down. And as time went on, this catalyst was very brittle. And later on, a catalyst, the Durabead catalyst, which was a catalyst in which the ground fines from the process were put back in the catalyst being formed, and it gave a very resistant catalyst for processing. Attrition was always one of the problems. You might be careful. I think there's going to be some film. Sit over a little bit. The early catalysts were the synthetics with the silica aluminas. The old company that I was with, Nelco, found that during the war they had made a synthetic ion exchange material. And lo and behold, if you treated this with ammonia, replaced the sodium with ammonia, it gave a fairly active cracking catalyst. And that was used during the war. And after the war, they began to, the World War II that is, they began to make a synthetic material, and they came up with a catalyst with 13% alumina on silica. And about the same time they began to spray dry, they began to learn that they could make little droplets of catalyst. And these catalysts in microspherical form were much more attrition resistant and much more effective. Well, later on they found that if they put 28% alumina in, it was even a more stable catalyst. And the only trouble was alumina was a lot more expensive than silica. And so you had to have an argument for using the more stable, higher alumina catalyst because it cost more. About that time, this was in the early 50s, Filtrol, one of the competitors, and by the way, one of the companies we now own, as of the merger that was just consummated. We may not keep Filtrol, but at the moment we own Filtrol. Filtrol discovered that they could take an halloysite clay, this is one of the early catalysts, and it's a tubular clay, and by acid activation, they found that they could make a very active, stable catalyst and a lot cheaper than the synthetic silica aluminas. And so they came out with this, and they began to steal the market on the synthetic catalyst manufacturers. About that time, I got involved, and we scratched our heads and tried to figure out a number of ways to compete with them. And we finally discovered a very inexpensive, high-purity clay called kaolin. It's the kaolin that's used, and I've discussed a little bit, I think, but it's used to coat your books, the glossy cover, the glossy pages in your books. That's all kaolin clay. Kaolin clay is like a fish scale. When you lay it on a surface, it gives a high gloss, a high white surface. Well, it's very cheap and very low in iron. And so we had the idea, why not combine kaolin with the silica aluminum? Put a cheap material in with the other. We did, and lo and behold, it worked. And that matrix is still being used today. It's kind of a pleasing thing for me. Quite accidental, really. But this catalyst has more than the people who looked at it from the outside realized. I think it was the first cracking catalyst to have a dual pore structure. And we'll talk about that a little bit next time. Well, Davison heard of it, and Davison is a very fast-moving outfit. They exchanged a license agreements with Nalco, and they came out with their version of what we call the semi-synthetic cracking catalyst. Things went along about that speed until about 1961, 62, when Charlie Plank from Mobile discovered that if you take an ion exchange, a sodium Y or a sodium X sieve with rare earth, you obtain an extremely active, extremely stable catalyst. As we talked about that before, that was the beginning of the era of really high activity, high stability catalysts. It led to many new developments in catalytic cracking, and in fact, it's really the reason why we can go after reduced crude conversion today, because we have a catalyst that's so active and so stable and so resistant to metals that we can do things that catalysts couldn't do before. Some other things were discovered. Most of these catalysts are silica aluminas, either in the crystalline form or in the amorphous silica aluminas. But it was discovered that if you combine silica with magnesia, you get a very active cracking catalyst, but it gives you a little different product distribution. It gives you more product toward the middle of the barrel. And so the silica mag catalysts were born. Unfortunately, they died a morning. The silica mags are not too thermally stable. In about 1450 degrees, you get a thermal transition to enstatite. The catalyst sinters, loses activity, and it can become a very disastrous operation very quickly. We subsequently worked on silica mags, and we found a way to avoid that, but at the present time, the sieves are so active that silica mag has not been of great interest. More recently, of course, ways have been found to make even more stable sieves, new and improved matrices. The kaolins are still used as a diluent. And by the way, one of the advantages of the kaolin filler, which is not fully appreciated, is that it does not carry water of hydration. So if you have a catalyst plant that can produce 100 tons a day of cracking catalyst, with your spray drying, your water evaporation capacity, when you add 30 or 40% kaolin, you don't have to dry the water off of that portion, so you can increase the plant capacity up to maybe 130, 140 tons a day. And in these days of energy conservation, it's turned out that this kaolin addition has another advantage, which we were well aware of, but we didn't realize it would be so important. Also, the kaolin acting as a house of cards, it gives you this dual pore structure, and then bonded together with silica gel. Well, those of us who are involved in the structural design of catalysts, we get inside the catalyst and on the surface, and we visualize how to move this and that about, and it's a highly exciting field in its own right, and I think we're developing a capability here for advancing the art. Now, if you'll take your book out, and I hope you all brought your books, because I want to follow along there a little bit. I hope you've read the introduction, page 86 and 87. And by the way, for those of you who do not have textbooks, we still are ordering some. I don't know how many we've ordered now. We must be up to close to 100. Are we, Tom?
I think so.
Of course, if you don't make every meeting, you have to give it back. Well, let's look at some of these models of catalytic cracking on page 88. I think maybe we can have the slides. I think that one is up. Let me move these aside. By the way, there's so much to cover, it may be that I jump around. I've tried to put organization into this, but there are so many things, so bear with me. If something gets out of order a little bit, well, we'll come back to it later on. But the catalytic cracking process is really quite simple. Some of these ways of circulating the catalyst that we've already talked about, I think the third lecture where we covered all these processes in that handbook, covered it fairly well. But in essence, you take your regenerator, the catalyst comes up, the spent catalyst with coke on it, you burn the carbon off, the catalyst overflows, comes down this standpipe, and because it's in the standpipe, it actually builds a pressure so that you can have a pressure differential across these two vessels and maintain it, and this leg acts almost as a seal. The oil picks up the catalyst. The catalyst comes through this valve here, is controlled, into the reactor. Now remember that the regenerator picks up temperature from the heat of combustion. Temperatures are 11 to 1200 degrees. As I pointed out to you, Ashland runs them a lot hotter. Ashland runs them up to 1350. So the catalyst comes down here 1250 to 1350 with the oil. Goes into the reactor. The reactor temperature is controlled, and you get a heat balance situation here. Spent catalyst drops down along the outside here, is picked up by air, and lifted back up, and the cycle is completed. That was Esso's model number two. And of course, Esso's been in this for a long time. As you recall, first fluid unit went on stream in 1942. The Model 3 was putting these vessels at the same height and simply, again, moving catalyst, picking up the spent catalyst to the regenerator, overflowing, dropping down, and with feed coming back to the reactor. So you just have a closed loop, down, over, down, and over, and back and forth. You'll note that there's more valves involved here, and there is a pressure from this height of catalyst. And so eventually some of this valving was eliminated and the process was simplified even more. However, all these reactors still are the homogeneous reactor. As you recall, the homogeneous reactor, the molecules are in the bed a long time. The catalyst is in there an indefinite period of time, as I showed you several lectures ago. And so you have microspheres with a lot of coke and microspheres with a little bit of coke. You have molecules that have been in there a long time, molecules that have been in there a short time. And what you're trying to do is to get an average residence time. And as I pointed out to you, the homogeneous reactor is extremely poor in giving control of residence time. Well, as these catalysts became more active, and as they began to realize that if you had a catalyst active enough, that you might actually get all the conversion you needed in the transfer line, the emphasis began to go to that sort of a system. And here's a typical transfer line reactor. The catalyst is picked up here with the fresh feed, transferred here in a riser type of operation. You'll notice there's no catalyst above it. The catalyst is disengaged. The gas goes this way, the catalyst drops down, comes down here, is purged of hydrocarbon, and into the regenerator, where the carbon's burned off, and it's again returned to the reactor. And there were several different designs. The UOP stack design, we have a UOP stack reactor. If you look out, see that big cat cracker off the hill, that's a stack reactor. The engineering department, George Myers, Paul Walters, Ollie, and so forth, they were clever enough, they put another riser on. That unit actually has two risers on it, one on each side. One over on this side and one behind that you can't see. Again, the idea was very similar, except in this case, there was some conversion in the line, but also sort of a polishing off in the reactor as well. The stack reactor made it easy to construct. Then Kellogg came along with their orthoflow. Ortho simply means upright, really. And they carried out the entire reaction without any of these outside lines. It's kind of a daring sort of thing to carry out an oxidation and a reduction, so to speak, within the confines of a single vessel. I think that's the amazing thing about catalytic cracking. I was talking to someone the other day, and I said I was very interested in fluid reforming at atmospheric pressure. But I said, "Oh, you can't do that. That's dangerous. You've got hydrogen and oxygen all close together." I said, "Well, that's the same as cat cracking. Cat cracking has been going on for many years, and you have oxygen and hydrogen being generated and hydrocarbons in contact with very, very closely in contact or very close relationship, so that any failure of one of these lines could give you that mixing." And I think it's a tribute to the engineering people that they've been able to design these units. I don't recall of any discussions of a cat cracker blowing up. There may have been some, but I don't recall them. So it's well, in detail, this is a reactor. The catalyst and oil come up, and you see this is a diluted bed. There may be 4 to 6 pounds per cubic foot here, whereas over here in this part of the bed, there may be a neighborhood of 20, 30 pounds per cubic foot. The hydrocarbon is really lifting the catalyst. As the hot oil hits the catalyst, it's converted to lower volatile molecules, which lift the catalyst and carried up the riser, disengaged in this area. The gases pass up overhead. They enter the cyclone, drop out the catalyst that's left entrained, move on to a second cyclone where they spiral again. Catalyst drops out, and the product goes out the upper end of the cyclone. Spent catalyst is brought down both sides, and here we strip. We don't want to take any good hydrocarbons in the regenerator and burn it. What we want to do is get rid of all of it, if we can, anything that's of value, obviously, and also to increase the capacity of the unit, because many of these units are limited by the coke burning capacity or the amount of air they can bring into the system. So steam is injected here and hydrocarbon is pushed back up. Finally, the spent catalyst is brought down to the regenerator. In the regenerator, you have a similar kind of operation. The spent catalyst from the reactor comes in, flows across here. And by the way, it looks rather simple, catalyst coming in. But you should see this big unit of ours. If you take it apart and go inside, you'll find all kinds of grids here. They have what they call a sort of a ski slide. This catalyst coming down, I think it's George Myers' device. Catalyst hits and splashes up and deflected, so you get better distribution. And you can play with these reactors and regenerators and change distribution considerably. Well, then the regenerator air comes up here, burns the carbon off. The flue gas containing carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide, and SO2 and nitrogen, of course, goes through these cyclones and out, and some of the catalyst is knocked out and put back in the bed. There's little flapper valves here. When this cyclone fills up, there's enough weight of catalyst in this dip leg, then it opens it up. When it dumps, you see if this couldn't close, then the air could go up this way and you'd lose your cyclone capability. So there's a little flapper valve here. When this loads up, it opens. As soon as this dumps, it closes. And of course, it means that this catalyst has to be able to flow in that cyclone dip leg. Otherwise, the system wouldn't work. And we do have lots of problems there. If these cyclones aren't working, the dip legs, of course, then the cyclone carries all the catalyst out. You have a lot of particulate matter, which, of course, the Environmental Protection Agency is very much concerned about. You have the air grid coming up, and finally, the regenerated catalyst goes back to the reactor. Well, this is simply the full story of a cat cracker system. This is the Model 3, the SO Model 3 unit, which I showed you, the back and forth loop. Here, if you have a lot of CO coming out, it can go through what's called a waste heat boiler, where the carbon monoxide is converted to a settler. Unfortunately, it's not always settled very well, this slurry settler takes a slurry decant oil, and the slurry oil, the rest of it coming off, is recycled. This decant oil is taken to our pitch unit and converted into petroleum pitch. So that's basically how the system works. Of course, you got your high octane gasoline, which is the plus your light ends, your C3s, your C4s. I just want to show you this. It's in your book, The Thermophore Catalytic Cracking. I think it's really an ingenious device, and it's really the forerunner of the present CCR, the Continuous Catalytic Reforming Unit we have here, because the idea of regenerating and taking pellets and moving them around is what's involved here. By the way, fellas, there's some seats here yet. If you want to sit down, it's okay. Anyhow, the spent catalyst passes through the reactor, and then you can imagine the problem of trickling these spheres down through this bed and sealing off so that you get no air down here. This is the kiln. This is where the carbon is burned off. There's purge steam in here, which of course purges the hydrocarbons from the catalyst, and also acts as a block so that the air doesn't get up into the reactor. Then you have a catalyst cooler to adjust the catalyst to the temperature you'd like for conversion. And it's brought down here and brought in a lift pot system, which lifts it to the top, and the catalyst then trickles back down through. In the old days, they had a mechanical elevator here. And this elevator picked up the catalyst and lifted the top, and pretty straightforward way of solving the problem. It would do the job. Had a few mechanical problems. No good lubrication at high temperatures. Harold, tough problem. Well, this is just to show you the types of yield you get from FCC and a TCC and perhaps the old Hoodry catalytic cracking unit. And I won't have time to go through that tonight, but generally speaking, the selectivity performance of the fluid process is much better than the TCC process, particularly as you work on higher boiling feedstocks. The TCC process can only work on a down flow system. The oil eventually has to vaporize, and so if you use a very heavy oil and you can't get vaporization, you know, how do you get it out of there? They tell me, Ollie tells me that in the late 40s, we had a TCC unit here, and probably Harold recalls, and some of the rest of you. And they tried to put heavy oils on that, and they had separate lines that they brought in. They splashed against the hot catalyst trying to crack it. So actually, acid's been rusting with resid processing for a long, long time. Well, what I want to do before we go into a discussion of this is we have a movie. Unfortunately, I think the sound got wiped out, didn't it, Bill? But I think it'll show you how a cat cracker operates, and I think it's important that you actually visualize this. because even though we talk about the scrutinization and so forth, unless you see it work, come down to our pilot plant where we have it in plastic, it's hard to really imagine how this catalyst does flow and flow so easily.
Ladies and gentlemen, I thought that it would be helpful for you to see a model of the RCC simulator, the plastic unit designed by Don Lee, group leader for the pilot plant and the engineering staff, that was constructed for the purpose of better understanding the operation of the RCC unit, the 200 barrel per day unit that we are operating at Catlettsburg, and to give us an ability to visualize problems that occur in the large unit. This unit was constructed and modified many times and has followed almost perfectly the large RCC unit. It is a 1/6 representation of the RCC unit at Catlettsburg. In this model, you will see, first of all, the lower and upper regenerator. This is the lower regenerator. The upper regenerator is at this point here. There is an external circulating line which can move catalyst from the upper regenerator, where a small amount of carbon is removed, to the lower regenerator, where completion of carbon removal is achieved. Carbon removal is taken to less than 0.1% in order to obtain the maximum performance of the catalyst before it returns to the reactor. There is also an internal circulation line which we have designed and placed in operation, members of the engineering department, in order to give a much better circulation and to give control of the circulation of the generator, the catalyst is stripped of air and returned down to the bottom to the reactor, where the fresh regenerated catalyst and oil are brought together and taken through what is called the riser up to the disengaging section. Section, which you will note at the top, has, among other things, a vented riser. A vented riser is a unique device designed to give instantaneous separation of product from catalytic cracking and the catalyst. Little, if any, overcracking of gasoline occurs. In this way, we obtain a maximum yield of our most desirable products. It is a rather ingenious device and is now becoming of considerable interest to the petroleum industry. Other companies have learned of this development and are very interested in it. The spent catalyst containing approximately 1% carbon is then dropped to the bottom of the reactor. Catalyst is stripped of any remaining hydrocarbons by means of steam and then returned to the upper regenerator where the cycle is completed. For those of you who are not familiar with the fluidized process, I should tell you that the name fluidization comes from the fact that the catalyst is very small in size and under the pressure or flow of gas, becomes a fluid-like substance which is easily moved from one vessel to another. Following this little discussion, I'm going to bring the camera up close so that you can see the interface between the catalyst and the gas, and also see what is called the dilute phase, where a much smaller concentration of catalyst resides and is carried above the dense bed of catalyst. If you look carefully here, you will see the interface between the dense bed and the dilute bed. Notice the agitation in the dilute phase as well, and the liquid-like properties in the dense phase. Turn to the remainder of this talk, I'd like to introduce to you some of the people involved in construction, design, and operation of this unit. First of all, I'd like to introduce you to Don Lee. Don is a group leader in charge of the pilot plants and was the man who inspired us to build this unit. Don has had a great belief in the value of plastic models for studying processes such as this. I wonder if we have some of the other fellows involved in construction operation of this. I believe Roger Bensley is not with us today. Roger has devoted considerable time to directing the construction of these units. In fact, we have two of them, one to simulate the present operation and one to simulate some of the other versions. In addition, I have Fred Atkins here. Fred is a research technician, and Fred has been involved in putting all this together. He's a master of putting plastic together, and it's been a real fine job that you've done, Fred. Another young man who's been intimately involved in the pilot plant RCC program is Dr. Ed Saad. Dr. Ed is the young fellow that is operating our FCR unit, the pilot unit that we operate in the pilot plant, which also attempts to operate in the same mode as the RCC unit.
Before I put that on, I want to, I think we'll have to move those back, Bill. I want to go back to the ones that are marked with black letters, black numbers instead of, I want to pass these out. You want to just send these out, maybe take some back to back in? There's the section on at 95, it talks about cracking reactions. And it gives a nice little discussion. And so I don't lose any of you. Those of you who have the book, fine. Those of you who don't, let's just remember, see if I can draw this. Basically, what we're talking about we have a silica structure. Silica, as you know, has a valence of +4. We put an alumina in there once in a while. We just force that alumina into the system. And so the alumina wants to pretend it's a +4, but it's only a +3. And so what it does, it attracts an OH system here to give a balance. But that leaves it with a plus charge. And the plus charge is transferred then to a proton, which becomes your Bonsted acid. So the mechanism postulated is that the carbonium ion forms by this hydrogen seeking two electrons, going into that double bond where we have electrons, and now leaving, essentially putting a hydrogen here and a plus charge there. And that's the whole story of carbonium ion mechanisms in its simplest form. But it, believe me, it's a lot more complex than that. And you'll read about it here in your book. But because I wanted you to have a classic education in catalytic cracking, I've arranged for you to have copies of what I consider a real classic paper in catalytic cracking, as extremely pertinent today, and I think that there are a lot of people who would do well to study it, because it involves not only catalytic cracking but thermal cracking on the surface of a solid. Thermal cracking, where you simply get the molecules up to high temperature and get a crack in a vapor phase, as against bringing that molecule against a surface where the heat can be concentrated, does in fact give you different kinds of product distribution along the thermal cracking line. As you get this beta scission that we talked about and a lot of ethylene formation. But if you do it on quartz, you get it one way. If you do it on alumina, the alumina likes to take the hydrogens off and put it back as hydrogen molecules. So when you go thermal cracking with alumina, you get more hydrogen. With carbon, it likes to take the hydrogens off and put them back on, so you get quenching. So if you crack on a quartz surface, you get a lot of ethylene. If you crack on a alumina surface, you get ethylene plus you get an alpha olefin. If you crack on carbon, you get the cracking, but it's saturated again. So that's part of understanding catalytic cracking too, because we're dealing with thermal, we're dealing with this high temperature surface, and at the same time we're dealing with a carbonium ion mechanism. And it's postulated that the reaction really starts with a thermal crack. In some way or another, a hydrogen atom is extracted, leaving an unpaired electron. As you recall, we said it could break beta. This electron attracts electron from over here. They pair up, you get an olefin, and you end up with another free radical here. And for those of you who study kinetics of free radicals, you know there's a chain reaction with free radical systems. This free radical will swipe hydrogen from another molecule, leaving a new free radical, plus this one is saturated. And so in this case, they took off CH3, but really, how we remove this hydrogen is a subject of a separate discussion, really. What did I do with my... Well, it's backwards. We get the crack, and we get the free radical, and we continue. But the important thing is, I hope you can read that, I hope these aren't all backwards. We try to get them in there, pretty hard to read this afternoon. Main thing is you get an olefin. And now with an olefin, you're set up to go after... Get an olefin, put the proton on. Now you've got this carbon is satisfied, this carbon is still charged, it's still looking for electrons, and this hydrogen can shift back and forth, bounces back and forth. It really doesn't care if it's a symmetrical molecule which carbon it's on. But you can get these hydrogen shifts. So you can start out with let's say this is a primary. Then this hydrogen will shift over, you get a secondary carbonium ion. So the idea of, in that 1001 that we're talking about, You have to get a free radical crack. You have to get an olefin. The olefin initiates a carbonium ion. The carbonium ion is a chain reaction because this carbonium ion can catch a molecule in midair, so to speak, as it comes down, extract a hydrogen ion to give it a saturation, leaving this molecule with a plus charge, which in turn adsorbs, which in turn cracks, which in turn extracts and converts another molecule into a carbonium ion, and so the chain goes. And when you think of that all going on within that 1,001 seconds in the riser, it truly is a remarkable thing, because not only does it have to do all this, but it has to diffuse to the catalyst in the resid process that we're talking about, the reduced crude conversion. We drop it, we put a drop of oil really on, so the molecule not only has to get to the site, but it has to get there by diffusing through the liquid rather than the solid, or rather through the gaseous phase. And so it's a double challenge for the molecule, and you know, Lloyd and I were talking about that, and we both had to agree it just doesn't seem possible it can happen, but nevertheless it does. Well, I can see I'm going to have trouble with all these. You can follow these in your book and what I, or this paper, and what I really want you to have this to read. And if you don't read it, at least have it in your portfolio. I think it gives you an appreciation of the intellectual or the mechanistic side of catalytic cracking as against that big old piece of hardware down there that's running day after day, month after month, year after year. This simply portrays, and Bill, you may have to take the top off that, and we'll flip these slides around if it gets more complicated, because these are still all right, but it simply conveys the idea that you get a chain reaction and you get an olefin. I don't know how those all got turned around. Yeah, can all of you read backwards? Well, it's the same thing going either way, really. This is just to convey to you, it's our old friend alkylation that I spoke to you about before. Remember, we took isobutane and combined it with isobutylene to make isooctane. Well, I think you might just well flip them all around. All they have to be is just turned around, Bill, I think.
Don't turn them upside down. Flip them. Yeah.
No, just, I think just... If you once see the pattern on one, Bill, they're all the same, then... This is to convey to you that primary ion can react with this proton. This proton can shift and come over here to give you a secondary. And in the sense, for a moment, you have a double bond here with this proton floating in between. There's many acidic reactions where the rate of reaction is dependent on this proton approaching the double bond and forming a complex, and then actually a conversion where the electrons are paired up and it splits open to this system here. I have to apologize. I pulled in about 2 o'clock this afternoon. These slides were on my desk and they were so hard to read. I had difficulty, but again, as you'll see here, a carbonium ion, as we talked about, the beta bond rule comes off, Now, this is an isomerization reaction. Remember, we have a linear chain, and we want to go to an isobutane. How do we get there? We get a beta bond scission, but it never leaves. The double bond forms here. In other words, the electrons go in there, neutralize that, give you this methyl group carbonium ion. But again, it's not free to move, and the purpose of the other slide is to show you that the hydrogen can migrate, and this methyl carbonium ion will migrate also. So it goes in here. Again, the hydrogen shifts over, and now you have your isobutyl radical, or carbonium ion, which is the most stable. And once that forms, then it can extract a hydrogen from another molecule and go on to isobutylene. Well, this is to portray that the carbonium ion interacting with the previous carbonium ion is non-selective as to where that first extraction occurs. And therefore, if it occurs in the middle of the molecule, then you'll get two neat little fractions. You get a C5, 6, 7. So you get a heptene and a nonane carbonium ion. These are both gasoline fragments. And that's what you want. Well, we can just go on and on with this, but what it portrays is that the carbonium ion and that C3 group likes to move to give that stable tertiary carbon carbonium ion. And once that forms, then it can crack beta again, and this chain reaction continues, and we get all these nice goodies. Let me back it up. I'm going to kill two birds with one stone here. That's simply to portray you can have carbonium ions with naphthenes too. However, I want to just take a minute to talk about how aromatics crack, because I think that's a separate group and there isn't a lot of discussion in here. But if you want to measure the acidity of a cracking catalyst, one of the ways you do it is to pass cumene over the catalyst. And not too many wires here. Cumene it's a high octane component. Now, if I pass cumene over a cracking catalyst, this proton thinks that this is really a double bond. It isn't. It's a resonating bond for the aromatic system, but it does think it is. And the proton ends up over here. Of course, it ends up many places, but it can move around. And that leaves this bond now just a single bond. It disrupts this resonating system. It leaves a plus charge there. Using the beta bond scission, the crack occurs here because we now have a double bond here and here, which are very hard to crack. It breaks it here, and you end up with propylene and benzene. The proton is left back on the catalyst again. This is a very fast reaction. And we use it to characterize cracking catalysts when you really want to get at the acidity and leave some of the other reactions alone. Well, one of the reasons you get such high octane numbers is because of this reaction when you have these big molecules with aromatic fragments. You see, if this chain is quite long here, and I crack this, well, I get a benzene, or maybe I'll have a couple of methyl groups on there, so I have toluene or xylenes. So I get a nice, beautiful xylene high-octane molecule. I get a fragment here, and I get some isomerization there, and I've got all kinds of nice gasoline molecules, high-octane molecules. Well, just to give you one more flair for, this is one that's so frequently misunderstood that I always feel desirable to re-emphasize. I think I already talked about it, but one of the little beasts that cause us a lot of trouble. I'll put our groups, for those of you who are not, those are alkyl groups. And now I'm going to make this system resonate. So I've got phenanthrene. Phenanthrene boils, as you recall, up around 600. It's no good for gasoline. It's not very good for heating oil either, because it's the kind of a molecule that makes a lot of soot when you try to burn it. It's not good as a cetane, it has a very poor cetane number. What do you do with that kind of molecule? You'd like to get it and say, boy, there's a lot of goodies in there. Well, that's where hydrotreating comes in. Because this double bond here, it doesn't really know what it is. It really can't decide whether it's a resonating aromatic system or an olefin. And so with a cobalt moly catalyst, with just a little bit of hydrogen, you can slip hydrogen in here. And now this thing is saturated in this bond. Now your acid site can attack here, giving you a carbonium ion here, cracking beta. And now I've got two fragments that are dangling by this bond here. That's all. Okay, we give that a crack, and now I've got a nice aromatic molecule here with a high octane number. I've got a nice aromatic molecule here. These little fragments came along with it. Instead of getting coked, or a molecule that I don't like at all, I get a nice high octane gasoline. So a little bit of hydrotreating, this is one of the tricks of the catalytic chemist. He studies the mechanism, he sees what you're trying to get, he says, hey, if I can just get that bond, crack it, I'm in. And this is why we run a hydrotreater here. We take hydrogen from the reformer, take it over there, take about 60% of the sulfur, a little bit of the nitrogen, but we set this molecule up for catalytic cracking. Well, there's a whole bunch of slides, and the luck I've had with those slides, I'm afraid to go through the rest of them. Yeah. Why don't we just turn all of them around, huh? I think that's all you have to do. Go through all of them. While you're doing that, I'll just do this one. There's a lot of tables in this book, and this is some beautiful work, because if you study this paper, you have a beautiful feeling for these mechanisms. But what I wanted to show you, and by the way, we made some runs on cetane, which is unheard of, really, in our cat tractor pilot plant. And I don't think we still worked over all the data on that, but we're going to try to put out a report on that, present it. One of the ACS meetings. It's unusual to run a pilot plant with cetane, I might add. But if you take normal cetane and pass it over a cracking catalyst, and this is an old catalyst, but it still is a carbonium ion cracking catalyst, here's what you get. You get very little ethylene now, or ethane. You recall, in thermal cracking, you get lots of ethane. And if you look at these tables, you'll see that when you thermally crack, there's lots of ethane showing up. But not with the carbonium ion. It starts to go up with the propylene and propane. Your butylenes and isobutylene come down here, finally back down here. You get some C7 and C8. The main thing is, though, with this normal paraffin, what you've done is dump most of this stuff into the range where you can either get high octane gasoline, as you know, normal cetane would have an octane number if you could run it, about a minus 100, I guess. If heptane is zero, cetane is, what is it, Harold? Can't measure it. Time. So this is the important thing. The catalytic cracking gives you this kind of distribution. If we have aromatic fragments, in other words, if we were to run this with aromatic molecules or moieties attached to the cetane, these would come off in this region, giving us these highly branched, highly olefinic, highly aromatic fragments of very high octane number.
So, in Table A is a summary of the difference in cracking with thermal cracking and catalytic cracking. As you recall, thermal cracking gives you poor yields of low-octane gasoline, lots of coke, and lots of ethane. But it is a great way to make ethylene for polyethylene manufacturing. So thermal cracking gives you major product, your C2s with much C1 and C3s. You get a lot of alpha olefins, few branched aliphatics. You crack within the side chain. A double bond shifts slowly. Little skeletal isomerization. Hydrogen transfer is a minor reaction. You crack at about the same rate as corresponding paraffins. You crack at lower rates than paraffins. You crack at lower rate with the alkyl groups and the naphthenes. And with the aliphatics, a small amount of aromatics formed at 500. Catalytic cracking, major product is C3 to C4 with normal hexadecane. Few alpha olefins. You crack next to the ring with alkyl aromatics. You get double bond shift with the olefins. Hydrogen transfer is an important reaction. A very high cracking rate. Crack at about the same rate as paraffins with equivalent structural groups. And crack at higher rates than paraffins. And I'm just going to take 1 minute to show you a little graph that I put together some time ago. I'm going to leave you with this, and we'll go on to more detail of cracking. For, I guess I say my own comfort more than anything. And the reason I did it is I was trying to visualize what these catalysts had to do in cracking resid. No, I think you had pretty good, Esther. Well, I need to scale over here. Okay. What I did was I said, what's different between the new catalyst and the old, and what do we need to get the cracking we need in the face of thermal reaction? Because we don't want a thermal reaction with the resid. But we know we have a lot tougher baby to deal with, and it's going to deactivate the catalyst more rapidly. So, went back and said, well, look, in the days before the zeolite catalyst, we knew that they usually ran at 900 degrees, and at 900 degrees they could outpace thermal cracking. Now, in order to keep our catalyst working today, we have to go up to higher temperatures with this resid. So I said, all right, the activation energy for thermal cracking is well known, and for catalytic cracking. Catalytic cracking, the activation energy is around 30 kilocalories per mole, thermal cracking, 65 kilocalories per mole. This is a log K versus 1 over T, the old familiar Arrhenius plot. And what I said was, let's assume that the reason we operated in the past was that we knew that at 1100 degrees, the thermal and the catalytic catalyst would be equal to one another. So if you take this curve here, it says that if you run silica alumina or thermal, and by the way, taking the Greensfelder data too, you'd say that at this point, at 1100 degrees, the two reactions are equivalent, and you should get a lot of thermal cracking and poor product distribution. However, the zeolite catalysts have a relative activity of almost 100 times the old silica alumina catalyst. So if I take a catalyst that's on a log scale here, one unit is a tenfold increase in activity. What it says, if I put this catalyst parallel, the same activation energy, that it'll be up to 1300 degrees before the thermal ever catches up with the catalytic. And if I assume I have a catalyst that's 100 times as active, then it doesn't catch up until I get up to 1500 degrees. Now, the coking reaction, by the way, is a very low activation energy here. And you see, again, going up in temperature for our own desirable reaction, we're catching up this coking reaction, so we ought to get more conversion for the same amount of coke. And so I think this is one reason, too, that our selectivity isn't too bad with the reduced crude converter. Now, another thing happens, of course, as you get to these high temperatures, diffusion begins to control the rate of the reaction. In other words, reaction is fast, so rate controlling is the diffusion to the site. So all these activation energies begin to bend over. And so there is a leveling out effect. The main thing I want to convey to you is that there is an activation energy for thermal. There is an activation for a cracking catalyst. The rate of reaction is such that at 900 degrees, the old silica luminous had an advantage of 10 to 15 fold. The new zeolites have an advantage of 100 or more. If we're working the catalyst hard, we still can beat the thermal reaction. And by the way, not only are we trying to beat the thermal reaction, we're trying to beat the coking reactions that come from nickel and vanadium coking. These reactions, as you raise the level of nickel and vanadium on the catalyst, those reactions speed up proportionately to some degree anyhow, to the amount of metal on the surface. And by having these very active catalysts, it's our objective, among many others, in developing catalyst systems for the RCC, is that in fact we'll keep that activity so high that even the coking reactions, the side coking reactions, not the basic coking reactions associated with catalytic cracking, which we've not been able to find a way to reduce that yet. But as far as the coking reactions are concerned, we will be able to